Up next, we have Ambassador Teresita Daza of the Department of Foreign Affairs. Ma'am.
Maraming salamat po at magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. Allow me to read the Department of Foreign Affairs statement. On the part of the Department of Foreign Affairs, our resolve to continue pursuing our mandate of protecting and upholding the country's legal maritime entitlements remains firm. We're making full use of diplomatic processes and are exercising all possible actions available to us. That includes summoning the Chinese ambassador, which we did this morning. I was just informed that because the Chinese ambassador was out of town, his DACM represented him. The matter was of urgent and important, and the department felt that the DCM was needed to be met by our Assistant Secretary Eileen Mendiola Rao. Ayungin Shoal is part of our exclusive economic zone and continental shelf, and we have sovereign rights and jurisdiction over it. Therefore, as we did in the past, we intend to clearly convey our position that we have every right under UNCLOS to carry out our legitimate activities in our maritime zones, and that we do not accept any form of interference. China, as a major power, bears a heavier responsibility of contributing to peace and stability in the region. Finally, I wish to take this opportunity to thank our partners in the international community for their steadfast support in the defense of the rules-based international order. Their statements of support show the level of concern that the international community has over persistent efforts to undermine UNCLOS. End of statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Daza. We may now open the floor for questions. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, sirs, ma'am. Katrina Domingo from ABS-CBN News. The Philippines and China established an emergency direct line between high-ranking officials in January 2023. That wasn't available, or at least the Chinese officials did not pick up calls from the Philippines during the water cannon incident. May we know the status of the direct line as of now? Was it used during this collision? And what is your assessment of its effectiveness as a tool between the two nations?
Thank you for the question, Katrina. So I think one of the first questions is, was it used? As far as I know, it was not used in this incident. And I'd also like to answer the second, which is in terms of the usefulness. Incidents in the past have shown that the usefulness of this mechanism is rather limited. So for this particular incident, the Philippines, the department decided to pursue the usual diplomatic route, and that is to summon the Chinese ambassador and to issue a protest.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, Celerina Monte from NHK. So, ma'am, just to clarify, so the DFA has already filed a diplomatic protest against China.
Yes, Celerina, we've already filed. The DCM was summoned. So the protest was also conveyed, and I'd like to give you the latest statistics when it comes to protests. So as of October 23, we've filed a total of 465 protests since January 2020. And out of that is 122 were lodged under this administration of our president. So as of October, and if you're looking at 2023, there are, let me just double check, 55 if I'm not mistaken. Let me just double check that number and get back to you, yeah?
Can I make a follow-up? Yeah,
follow-up. Go ahead, ma'am.
Ma'am, you have mentioned that China, as a big country, should be responsible in like contributing to the peace and stability in the region. So are you saying that China is disrupting the peace and stability in the region. And to Commodore Tariela, you have mentioned several violations under COLREG by the Chinese vessels. So what will be the action of the government? Will there be any filing of any, I don't know what, action or petition before any court or what, international court? Thank you.
I think what happened today with the incident yesterday, the Philippine government has come out to actually strongly condemn this dangerous, irresponsible, and illegal action of the Philippine Coast Guard and the Chinese Maritime Militia. We strongly believe China. This is our exclusive economic zone. This is our waters. China has no right to linger in and around the waters of Ayungin Shoal and actually to interfere with the Philippines' legitimate activities in and around the waters of Ayungin Shoal. The Philippines exercises sovereign rights and jurisdiction over Ayungin Shoal, which falls under the Philippines' exclusive economic zone and continental shelf as affirmed by the 2016 arbitral awards. We also want to underscore the Philippine vessels were undertaking a routine and regular humanitarian mission for Philippine military personnel aboard BRP Sierra Madre, consistent with Philippine rights under international law. It's rather difficult to imagine how these activities could be deemed as threatening or provocative to China. Not only did China actions endanger lives at sea, they're also illegal, dangerous, provocative, and deplorable. They undermine mutual trust, confidence, and respect that should underpin our bilateral relations and put into serious doubt the sincerity of the Chinese side to uphold the understanding between the President and President Marcos's presidency.
Question. On the part of the Philippine Coast Guard, of course, we can document and, of course, support the diplomatic actions of the Department of Foreign Affairs. Although I have mentioned those are rules that were violated by China for the collision regulation, all of this will still be submitted to the Department of Foreign Affairs. As to whatever diplomatic actions, of course, as what DFA has mentioned, they are going to be the one to handle this.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Good morning. Can I address my question to Yusek Malaya and also Ambassador Daza first? Although there's a statement already from the State Department, just for soundbite purposes, that this kind of action from China trigger, no pun intended, the MDT?
MDT is invoked when there is an armed attack. The incident that happened is aggressive and dangerous. It's a provocation on the side of China. But at this point, whether it will constitute an armed attack that would allow the invoking of mutual defense treaty is something that needs to be studied.
But of course, we know the complexion on the ground, right? I mean, the ones who are boarding the Chinese militia vessels and then the Coast Guard vessels of China. Are we factoring that kind of maybe nuanced deployment in figuring out whether this can trigger the MDT?
Okay. I think it's very clear from what we have shown you today, you know, from the videos and the photos and the deployment of China's overwhelming deployment in the Ayungin Shoal, that the provocative actions are on the part of China. No, it is not the Philippines that is increasing tensions. It is China that is increasing tensions in the West Philippine Sea, especially by interfering and blocking our legitimate resupply mission to Ayungin Shoal. And we consider this development as alarming, that the Department of Foreign Affairs summoned the Chinese ambassador this morning. And we would like to emphasize that. No, that is a clear and unequivocal message being sent by the Philippines to China, that we do not you know, accept what is happening, no? That there has been a collision already. And as we have seen very clearly through photos and videos, and as will be reported by our embedded media friends later on, by several networks, that their actions were the ones that caused this collision, okay? The urgency of the matter required the Philippine government to the Department of Foreign Affairs to summon the Chinese ambassador to express our displeasure over what happened, no? Because it was serious enough that it could have caused, it placed the safety of our Filipino crewmen on the line, and it would have caused more disastrous results, no? And we are just very thankful that nothing happened in this event, but it may happen in the future. That is why we are right now considering all possible actions, no, future actions, but those future actions, of course, will depend upon instructions from higher ups. And the President, of course, and the Secretary of National Defense and all relevant cabinet members have been informed by this development. But of course, whatever future action the Philippines may undertake will depend upon what instructions we receive from higher ups in the government.
With the job precarity facing the Philippine personnel, every time it conducts its resupply mission in a human zone, is the Philippine government inadvertently allowing them to be used as bait to trigger the MDT?
Of course not, no? What we're doing here is a legitimate Philippine operation, no? We are resupplying our troops in Ayungin Shoal. We are not undertaking any dangerous maneuvers of our own. As we have seen in the videos and photos, our ships were doing what is routine and routinary in this purpose. It is China who is utilizing the situation for its own advantage, no? To assert its claim over Ayungin Shoal and the entire South China Sea. It is not the Philippines, as I said, that is increasing tensions.
Thank you. Next question. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning. I'm Joanna Balyaran from GG Press. My question is addressed to Ambassador Laga. Ambassador, how does this incident affect the plans to file a case versus China's aggression in the South China Sea? Does it bolster the Philippines' case? And where do you plan to file the case?
The matter about filing another case is something that's still being studied by the government. But of course, all incidents like this will actually bolster the case that it's not the Philippines that's the aggressor, but the other party, which is China, that's actually undertaking dangerous maneuvers and blockades and putting at risk not only vessels, but more importantly, the people who are manning the vessels.
Thank you. Next question. Yes, sir.
Sir, Manny Vargas po from DCWB. Kay Commodore Tariela, yung pinakita niyo, sir, na damage doon sa BRP Cabra, does it mean na magpapalit tayo, sir, ng barko na magbabantay sa WPS to assess muna yung damage ng BRP Cabra? And may escalating situation, handa ba? Or do we have enough precautions para ingatan yung limited assets ng Coast Guard to ensure na meron tayong presence sa WPS? Thank you, po.
Well, for the first question, whether we're going to replace BRP Cabra because it has damage, no? I cannot answer that for now because, as I said, we have yet to evaluate the damage that BRP Cabra incurred because of the collision. Secondly, how are we going to protect our limited assets, no? From the previous resupply operations, you can see that, as what I've been mentioning, the Philippine Coast Guard has always been deploying skippers of BRP, different Coast Guard vessels, not just BRP Cabra, who have the ability to prevent from collision from happening. It just so happened that for this particular incident, the BRP Cabra was collided from behind. But from the previous photos and even the videos that I presented now in this resupply operation, you can see how skillful our commanding officers, no, in preventing having a direct collision from the Chinese maritime militia or even from the Chinese Coast Guard vessel. As I said, this accident only happened because we were hit from behind. And should this particular incident be occurring sana from our bow, no, from our path, this would have been prevented.
Thank you. Next question.
Yes, sir.
Good morning. Barnaby Lowe from Al Jazeera. I know that you've already explained what happened and the story from the Philippine side, but there have been a few statements from the Chinese side as well from yesterday. If you would just please address some of the points that the Chinese made. Number one, that the Unaizen Mei, the supply boat, deliberately crossed the bow of the Chinese Coast Guard ship. Number two, BRP Cabra reversed, which caused the collision with the Chinese maritime militia vessel. Siguro, two muna, and then two more later.
Okay. Sige, let me start by answering that, no? The statements made by China are not supported by evidence. You know, parang kinuha lang sa hangin. All right? As we have shown you specifically through videos and photos, no? The Unaisa May 2 was, as shown by Colonel Medel Aguilar and by Coast Guard Commodore J. Tariela, were moving in a regular direction, and it was the Chinese Coast Guard vessel that blocked the path. No, kita naman natin sa wake, makikita naman sa wake din. No? So I think that kind of statement, no, collapses in the face of overwhelming evidence. And as I said kanina, there is media that was embedded in this particular RORI mission, and it will be your colleagues who can make that, you know, judgment. No, if China does not believe the statement coming from the Philippines, but well and good, no, kung yan ang gusto nila. But there are other witnesses, third party witnesses. In fact, embedded media coming from different media institutions who can prove that it was not deliberate on the part of Unaisa May 2. Now, on the part of the Philippine Coast Guard, yung movement of a Cabra, may I turn over the floor to Commodore J. Tariela.
Thank you, sir. For the Philippine Coast Guard, as you saw from the video, no, hindi namin to ni-splice, hindi namin in-edit. So, I don't want to respond to such a statement of the Chinese government, because obviously we don't respond to lies. What we only present are all facts. These are supported by videos, these are supported by photos, and we have embedded journalists here. As far as our government is concerned, we have the freedom of the press, so we cannot dictate whatever reports that they're going to do in the next couple of hours. So I would give the responsibility to tell the right narrative, the factual ones, not made up, to those journalists who were embedded in that particular operation.
Two more points, sorry, just two more points that China raised, and they've been actually raising these two points time and again. They've said again that the Philippines had promised to tow away the BRP Sierra Madre, that's one, and that China had asked the Philippines not to deliver large-scale construction materials to the BRP Sierra Madre, but the Philippines keeps delivering these construction materials.
Answer the first one. In terms of the promise, we're not aware of any of such understanding, and I think no one in the Philippine government will ever enter into such agreement, abandoning its sovereign rights and jurisdiction in its EEZ and continental shelf. Moreover, the president has already made a statement on it. He already said that categorically denied the existence of it, and if whether there is such an agreement, he rescinds it. I think it would help if the media also help us in actually countering narratives that do not have basis. And this is one narrative that's coming from their end.
Thank you, ma'am. No, sorry. Next question, yes. Sorry, construction.
Please be informed that BRP Sierra Madre is our vessel, and it is within our rights to repair it, to make sure that it is habitable for our troops that are manning there to be safe, and to at least have a good night's sleep.
Can I just add this? The Chinese narrative always says that we're violating their sovereignty, but they are in our exclusive economic zone. They are there illegally, they're intruding, they're undertaking dangerous maneuvers. And the resupply mission to and the upkeep of the BRP Sierra Madre are legitimate Philippine government activities in our country's exclusive economic zone, which are all in accordance with international law, particularly UNCLOS. As a low tide elevation, Ayungan Shoal can neither be subject of a sovereignty claim, nor is it capable of appropriation under international law, which is a fact that was affirmed by the 2016 arbitral award. China cannot, therefore, lawfully exercise sovereignty over it. China's illegal exercise of maritime law enforcement powers, interference with legitimate Philippine rotation and resupply mission, deliberate and reckless dangerous maneuvers against our vessels, and any other activity that infringes upon Philippine sovereignty, sovereign rights, jurisdiction and territorial integrity are violations of international law. We demand that China immediately stop its illegal activities in our waters.
Thank you. Yes.
Hi, good morning po. I'm Camille Alamia from the New York Times. I just want to ask, the tension keeps on escalating, as you all said, care of China, but we've been hearing the same or similar things as response of the Philippine government. Summoning the Chinese ambassador, diplomatic protests, and rallying international support. But China is being belligerent and continues on pushing the limits. So should the Philippines step up in its response, the Philippines and like-minded allies?
Thank you for the question, Camille. The summoning of the Chinese ambassador is not something we do every day. Okay, we file diplomatic protests every now and then, but we don't summon the Chinese ambassador all the time. So this is also a clear message on the part of the Philippines. Well, the DFA took that into consideration, took the gravity of the urgency of the situation, and decided that this was an event that required the Philippines to summon the Chinese ambassador. Now, on the issue of despite provocations, we continue to proceed in this manner, precisely because by continuing to resupply the troops in Ayungin Shoal, we are actually implementing the 2016 arbitral ruling. Okay, because this is our way of asserting our rights. No, so no matter what odds we face, we will continue to do what is necessary. We will supply our troops in Ayungin Shoal, no matter the overwhelming odds. We will continue to provide supplies and food and gasoline to our fishermen who go to Bajo de Masinloc and elsewhere, because this is the Philippines implementing the 2016 arbitral ruling. No. By not doing so means that we are abandoning the arbitral ruling, and the arbitral ruling is binding not only to the Philippines but also to China. So this is our way of saying to the world that we are implementing the ruling and the world should support us. And as mentioned by Ambassador Tess Dasa, we have received a lot of encouragement and support from various countries, of which we are thankful for. As to other things, no, as to other things that you may wish us to do, like, for example, filing another case in another tribunal or increasing the deployment of additional ships from the Philippines, that will be decided by higher-ups. And we have still to receive instructions on how to proceed moving forward. But as you very well know, all options are on the table, and the government is considering other possible measures in the future as we move forward.
follow-up.
Thank you. Can I just make one follow-up? Sir, anyone po can answer. May update po ba dun sa, or kung may plans ba on joint RORES to Ayungin, like with other like-minded countries, and the status of that?
The RORE mission is for us to undertake.
Thank you. Yes.
Follow up on Camille's question. China's been consistently tried blocking and doing a lot of brazen acts recently for the past few months. Are we only limited to reporting this and also lodging a verbal agreement, not verbal, and to the 400 something that we have lodged against China, do we get to have any reply on those non-verbal? Thank you.
Yes, China has been replying to some. Sometimes it's it takes a number of protests and actually has one omnibus reply. So if you can say the communication is ongoing, which is important, I think, at this point, because from the department's perspective, we're always hopeful that China will act as a responsible member of the international community and that it will respect our sovereign rights, sovereignty and sovereign rights of our country. And if it wants to be a respectable member of the international community, it will do so and act so. Yeah?
We're only limited to reporting and lodging note verbal against this provocative actions.
There are a number of tools available with the department, but it's not in the nature of the department to actually register the action that will be undertaken. Mm-hmm. As you all know, sometimes some of you may have noticed, it takes a little bit of time for us to issue a protest. Mm-hmm. But a protest is undertaken, but it's something that is actually studied, reviewed, and assessed, mm-hmm. and the necessary action that needs to be done within within the parameters of the department is something that is undertaken. Mm-hmm. As I mentioned, the department remains committed. It will do its share, but you have to understand the parameters where the Department of Foreign Affairs is working. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Next question. Yes, at the back, ma'am.
Regine from Washington Post. Just to be clear, I wanted to ask Sirs and ma'am, is it accurate to say that this is the first time a collision of this nature has happened between government and government sanctioned vessels? Tama po ba?
Yes.
Okay, so it's I wanted to ask how precedented or unprecedented this is, and of course, we've already been talking about this, but for the sake of the soundbite, if you could tell us about how urgent, how dangerous it is, because some people might see the video and think it's, say, anticlimactic, it's a bomb, ganyan. But maybe if the experts could tell us how close are we to, yun, parang yung integrity ng hull, technical terms like that. What does it mean for... the danger of the crew, the Filipino crew on those ships.
What is dangerous here are the reckless maneuvers of China Coast Guard. And that should be known to everybody. Because without that, there will be no problem. They are not even authorized to be there in the first place. So let this be the message.
Did you want to add something, Sergei?
Yes.
Yeah.
As to your question, how dangerous the collision that happened to Unaiza May and to the Philippine Coast Guard vessel, let me first highlight the fact that the chartered indigenous boat that the Armed Forces of the Philippines is using to do the resupply operation is a wooden hull. No? Some of the structure of this chartered boat is actually wooden. So you can just imagine how big the China Coast Guard vessel, kung hindi siya talaga nakaalis from that collision point, it will be totally wrecked. No? Sirang-sira sana yung Unay sa May. So that's how dangerous it is. It is dangerous for the lives of the crew of Unay sa May and also for some of the Philippine Navy who were supposed to be rotated for our LS-57. On the part of the Philippine Coast Guard vessel, also the same thing. This kind of collision is very dangerous because it affects the seaworthiness of the Philippine Coast Guard vessel. It is also worth noting that the distance of Ayungin Shoal to the nearest port, particularly Buliluyan, is around 160 nautical miles. For us to be able to reach to the nearest port to save our Coast Guard crew and also for the crew of the indigenous boat, that's how dangerous it is. So it is important to mention this, that those kind of collision caused by a dangerous maneuver jeopardize the safety and the lives of our Coast Guard sailors and the crew of the indigenous boat.
Thank you, sir. And yes, sir.
Yes, Rihanna, I think we have time for two or three more questions and then we can wrap up the press con.
Just a quick follow-up din po. And I think Ma'am Daza wanted to say something, but I'll just add my quick follow-up. I know you're still evaluating but the seaworthiness of that damage done to Unay sa May. But I wanted to ask what would be an accurate way to describe what you already know about the damage. Is it still fit to sail?
Right now, Unay sa May is still on its way to the port. So we haven't really conducted the thorough evaluation of its seaworthiness.
Can I just
thank you? Yes, ma'am.
You know, China has the obligation under Article 58 of UNCLOS to give due regard to the rights and duties of the Philippines as a coastal state. Furthermore, China's actions are contrary to the flag state obligations of the government of the People's Republic of China under Article 94(3)(c) of UNCLOS to take necessary measures to ensure safety at sea and prevent sea collisions. The Chinese vessels' dangerous maneuvers restricted the PCG's vessels and the UM-2's navigational paths, which was the direct cause of the collision and a violation of Rules 2, responsibility, Rule 7, risk of collision, and Rule 8, action to avoid collision of the 1972 International Regulation for Preventing Collisions at Sea or Coleridge.
Thank you. Yes.
Hello. Good morning. I'm Cliff Benzon from Bloomberg News. Given the unprecedented nature of this collision, is Philippines concerned that China is using the Israel-Palestine and the conflict and also the Ukraine war to test the U.S. alliance ability to manage multiple crises at the same time? And I also ask my second question because they are somehow related. Do you have any sense or are there indications that U.S. and its partners are distracted or unable to provide the same level of support to the Philippines compared with prior to the Middle East conflict?
On the second question, I think the mere fact that a number of our partners have actually come up with statements, several of them immediately have come up since yesterday, shows that there is a steadfast support to defend the rules-based international order, and that there's also a continuing concern over countries that continue or persist in terms of efforts to undermine this rules-based order. So in terms of waiving, I don't think so, because if you note, the number of statements that came out from our partners is indicative of the support that they have and their concern raised regarding what is happening in our world.
Yeah, just to add to that, no, we don't see any wavering on the part of the United States in its support for the Philippines. In fact, the U.S. Embassy yesterday immediately released a statement, as mentioned by Ambassador Daza, and yesterday, likewise, there was a statement coming from the State Department itself, from the spokesperson of the State Department, where the United States said that the United States stands with the Philippines, no, in the face of these provocative actions in Ayungin Shoal and in the West Philippine Sea. And the United States has repeatedly said that its commitment to the Philippines is ironclad, no? Not only mentioned by President Biden, by the Vice President, but again, in the statement from the State Department, it also said that the U.S. reaffirms that Article 4 of the 1951 U.S.-Philippines Mutual Defense Treaty extends to armed attacks on Philippine armed forces, public vessels, and aircraft, including those of its Coast Guard and anywhere in the South China Sea. So, notwithstanding the events all over the world, no, we do not see any wavering on the part of the United States in its support for the Philippines.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hello po. Just want to ask first, what specific type of construction materials did we bring doon sa Ayungin Shoal? Kasi sabi po kanina parang nagmeron tayong construction materials na dala. So ano po sanang specific construction materials is that? And second is that, moving forward, ano na po yung adjustments na gagawin natin? Meron ba tayong in-explore perhaps to use helicopters instead sa pagde-deliver ng mga supplies natin po?
On the materials, it's just to maintain and repair that facility, that vessel that we have there.
So
no need to enumerate in specific what are those, just to assure everybody that it is for the upkeep of the vessel. On the operational details, I will not discuss that.
All right, thank you. Last question.
Malu Bartolome po from Business Mirror. Magandang umaga, sir, ma'am. Sir, it appears kanina doon sa video, napalibutan po yung mga barko natin ng mga militia, Chinese militia. Is this the first time that they're doing it? And is it also a matter of law enforcement? How about we send more ships to escort our resupply vessel? Because clearly, the area is within our exclusive economic zone based on the 2016 arbitral award. It's final and executory. Tama po ba? Final, binding, and executory na ba natin dapat? So we should have executed our law enforcement activity there. We should have arrested or we should have taken those militia, Chinese militias, into custody.
Well, first of all, no. For the past 3 months of the resupply operation, we have already documented that the Chinese maritime militia are now actively participating in the blocking operation of the Chinese Coast Guard. So this is not something new. As I said, this has been happening for the past months. I think what is only worth noting in this particular resupply operation is that the Chinese maritime militia collided with the Philippine Coast Guard vessel. As to your second question, whether are we going to deploy more Philippine Coast Guard vessels to support the resupply operation, that is another possibility, but as what Colonel Middell mentioned, that's part of the operational details and we're not permitted to disclose that. For the third question, would it be possible for the Philippine Coast Guard to arrest a Chinese maritime militia vessel? I don't want to answer that directly, but let me give you once again the summary of the vessels that were deployed in this particular operation. We only have two Philippine Coast Guard vessels. They have 5 Chinese Coast Guard vessels, and they have 16 Chinese maritime militia. So the question is it possible for us to arrest those Chinese maritime militias that are bigger than the Philippine Coast Guard vessel? As to the Coast Guard, we would want to, but I don't think that is something that we have to prioritize right now.
Let's we are outnumbered, no? Sorry, overnumbered. Outnumbered by Chinese. So, can we ask Ambassador Daza, the Americans, to help us deter the Chinese?
That's not for me to answer. It's not within my to be able to answer that. But I think the Americans have been very supportive in a number of fronts, whether it be in terms of disaster management, in terms of increasing effectiveness and efficiency, in terms of our modernization program of our armed forces. But as I said, it's not for me to answer that question.
All right, thank you very much. Ambassador Daza, we are going to
just
end.
Just one last question, please.
All right.
Ma'am, curious lang ako, what was the reply of the deputy ambassador kanina? You met, the DFA met with the representative. Now, what was the reply, if there are any?
I just was informed that it was held and that who met with whom. But in terms of more details, I do not have it. But it would be safe to assume that they will repeat the narrative in terms of what they've been sharing out with the media.
And the diplomatic protest with regard to this has been filed.
So now it's 55 for 2023. We already have 55 diplomatic protests, including that one, because that's the number that I've given is as of 23 October 2023, which is today.
55 this year. Okay, thank you. Thank you for your time, sir.
Sir Malaya, isa lang po. You have mentioned that...
Kasi mas humihirap yung mga tanong nyo habang tumatagal eh.
You have already reported incident with the president. So, we're wondering what's the directive of the president because as of now, Malacanang hasn't yet made any statement.
As I said kanina, there are meetings happening right now. No, in fact, there are high-level meetings happening right now in relation to this event, no, what happened yesterday, the collisions that happened. So we don't know what is transpiring right now because we're here in the press conference. So we'll probably have to wait for further announcements from Malacañang on what other steps are to be undertaken in response to what happened yesterday. Thank you very much for your attendance in today's press conference. Maraming salamat po.